Okay, pause. So what gave you the idea to do this slow motion kind of walking, moving?
Yeah, great question. So I tried to bring out that metaphor of the thick and the clear.
Oh, yes.
In the movement as much as I could. And so just to kind of loop our audience in, Andrew Lazo, who is another wonderful expert, similar to you, he's read the book a lot, he's taught it a lot. And so he and I had a conversation about the thick and the clear being a main metaphor. And it really goes back to what you were saying in one of our earlier conversations about the supernatural and the natural.
Right.
And so the supernatural is the thick. And so you see the priest walking in. And I basically just told the dancer to walk as thick as she possibly could.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. And this piece of music is by Ezio Bosso. And this track is just like this. It's a stopgap.
Oh.
So it's like the orchestra plays and then there's a silence.
Yeah.
And I thought for this entrance of the priest coming in to demand a sacrifice, right, there could be no more dramatic lead-in than kind of pausing and halting.
Okay.
And then the last thing I'll say about it is, because this is from Orual's purview, you know when you have a memory that you look back on, it's very traumatic, and you see it almost too clear, where it's like so vivid, the colors feel more intense and the smells, and you know exactly where you were and you can put yourself there.
Right.
I wanted to create a scene where Orual is kind of remembering that moment of the sacrifice being chosen and kind of heightening all of her senses, since she's telling this from the perspective of looking back on it in old age.
Oh, okay. That makes sense. And then why it would be that the pauses make it more, even more traumatic and dramatic. Okay, pause. So is this, it's representing confusion, right? Like they're all, the priests must be talking at this point and saying there needs to be a sacrifice, and the sacrifice will be to the god of the mountain, the shadow brute. That's where it needs to be done. But no one knows at this moment who is going to be sacrificed.
Yeah, that's exactly it. You got it. And at this point, I think Trom is concerned that he might be the one.
Oh, yeah, he is.
Yeah, so you see him kind of tying himself up in knots, which is basically his internal dialogue.
Yes.
And so something, you know, different from a play, let's say, right? If we're doing a play of Till We Have Faces, we'd have the dialogue and they would talk, but Trom would remain strong. He wouldn't necessarily show us all of that internal angst. Uh-huh,
right.
Whereas ballet is kind of the exact opposite. Mm. We like take out the on the surface words and we show you how the characters feel.
Right.
And so, yeah, I think that's one of the like the cool parts about it, and what makes it a great companion to the book Till We Have Faces.
Mm-hmm.
If you watch the ballet and then read the book or vice versa, you get the same information but kind of given to you through two different vantage points.
Yes. Yeah. It's good. Okay, pause. Why does the priest do that crazy paw, you know, motion? It's just so great. I love it.
No, Kayla Kowak is fantastic as the priest of Unget.
Yes.
She is. And yeah, I mean, when we were creating the movement, we were like, what feels religious and overdone and thick and basically as unclear as possible?
Yes. Okay.
And so all of her movement, we are intentionally obtuse, because that's how Orual feels right now. She's confused. She doesn't understand. Trom maybe understands a tiny bit more, but not a lot. And everybody's trying to figure out what this priest is babbling about. And so we try to just make really interesting shapes that are confusing, a little bit disturbing, concerning, so that the audience feels much like the royals feel at this point.
Yeah, and the way the priest is described in the book, he does have a bird's head, and he is, he's pretty old, and Orual often describes him with a lot of fear. Or disgust or something.
Yeah.
And that comes across in her motions. That's great.
Thank So in this section, we see the fox coming into the conversation a little bit more. Mm-hmm. Do you want to talk a little bit about his dialogue with the priest?
Yeah, so the fox, because he looks at everything through nature and rational, logical, so he tries to bring, as the priest eventually says, his Greek wisdom, and he tries to challenge what the priest is asking for, but the priest won't have it, and he's like, well, actually the fox says a child of six would talk more sense than going on here what the priest is saying, and but the priest counters him and says, no, there has to be a sacrifice. And I am here in the strength of Unget, and there will be a sacrifice. Mm-hmm. And I've been a priest for a long time. And so the supernatural needs to have a sacrifice so that we can heal the land.
Yeah.
But the fox, of course, doesn't believe that.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. Love that.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, pause. So it's funny, this was the premiere, and premieres are great, but we actually changed a few things by the time we got to the show at the Harris. Okay. So one thing that we actually are not seeing in the video that I changed in this sequence is there's kind of this iconic pose where Orual is pointing like this up at Ungit. And we added that in. So audiences that are gonna see BareFace now and the version you saw at the Harris, instead of doing what she's doing in this video, she actually runs and grabs the statue and points up at it, which is one of my favorite newer moments of the show. And I think helped a lot to establish the fact that Orual is angry at the gods.
At the gods, right.
And this is one of the first moments where you see the anger starting to boil in her.
Yes, yes.
Well, and especially because it's Psyche who has been chosen, and Orual loves Psyche. She's raised her since a baby, and of all, I think she even says that she'd rather be the sacrifice than have Psyche be the sacrifice.
Absolutely. Okay, pause. So we're about to see one of my favorite sequences in the show, and there's a couple of these like slow motion moments. Mm-hmm. So if you kind of watch it, you'll see the background blurs out, and there's a very kind of dramatic sequence. And I just wanted to kind of point that out because I think Orual has these certain character development moments that sharply change her trajectory. So can you tell us a little bit about how Orual changes from pre-Psyche sacrifice to kind of this moment where Psyche is given away? What change do you see from reading Till We Have Faces?
That's a good question. So she has complaints against the gods, but this is a big one. And she becomes very angry, even more so with the gods, that they are going to take Psyche away from her and be sacrificed. At this point, she thinks that she will die. Psyche is being kept in a pillar room, in a room before she's sacrificed. And Orual goes in and she thinks she's going to comfort Psyche, but Psyche ends up comforting her. And Orual is really upset with that because she has always been the quote adult and Psyche's always been the child, and she always calls Psyche a child. And the thing is, Psyche is becoming a mature woman. I mean, she's becoming an adult, and Orual is really upset with her, and also upset with her that Psyche is looking forward to going to the god of the mountain and being sacrificed. And Orual just doesn't comprehend that. And she says, well, then obviously you don't love me. And she doesn't realize that you can love several people at the same time, you know? And she thinks that Psyche is going to be sacrificed and that she doesn't love Orual, and she's not fighting to not be the sacrifice.
So good. I love that. I love that explanation. And I think it's so relatable.
Yes.
When you think about it.
Yes.
I feel like we've all been there.
Yes.
You know? I think of when my sister Angie got married, and she's 2 years younger than me. We were really close. And I remember really struggling when she fell in love with her husband. Because I was like, you're taking away
right
my sister. Like, she and I were so close that it felt like, how can this work? How yep. can you love him and we can still be close? Like, is that even possible?
Right.
And that's just a very, you know, little, almost silly example. But I think in life, that's so true. Mm-hmm.
It's very true.
And Lewis brilliantly draws out the difference between, like, real love, which mm-hmm. is sacrificial. And we see that in mm-hmm. Psyche. And then kind of this possessive, what I call the shadow side of love.
Where yes.
it's more of a possessive, jealous love.
Yes.
That is controlling. And right. so I love how you pulled out that, you know, delicate balance of kind of the relationship mm-hmm. and kind of what we're seeing here.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.